Marriage and Meditation, Part 4, Seven Bodies. Marriage requires three things. Number one, devotion. And as devotion deepens, love is born. And then love has to be fulfilled at all the levels, at the physical level, emotional level, mental level, etheric, and all the other seven bodies. And when it is fulfilled at all the seven bodies, all the different levels, then something is born out of you, out of this communion, and that is the renunciation. You are not renouncing the relation. Instead, the relation, the communion has reached its fruition when so much satiation comes that you are no more interested in operating at different levels. Instead, a new level of transcendence is born in you, and that is the renunciation. This is the way it is supposed to happen, but it does not happen in most of the cases. So far I had spoken until the fifth body. In the fifth body, that is the fifth layer, both life and death comes to you. One cannot get attached to either of the two. When you are attached, you are not accepting the polarity of its totality. You are bound to get sick. A simple example, that you have a coin. Each coin has two sides. You cannot remain attached to one side or the other. You cannot keep one and discard the other. Two stay together and two are discarded together same time. If you want to exchange the coin for something that is beneficial to you, you have to discard both polarities, the head and tail. You cannot remain attached to life. If you are, then death becomes a misery and you are remain afraid of death. Meditation teaches you what actually happens in the moments of death. In certain moments of love making, it teaches you the deepest aspect of death, when everything comes to a cessation. The breathing seems to be ceased, there is no emotions, and instead there is utter bliss. And this is the essence that one has to attain through this male-female relation. We are not aware of such moments when it comes, because we do not understand the relationship between love and meditation, between marriage and meditation. Marriage is based on devotion, and out of devotion, love is born. And the other side of the coin that love is meditation. Up to the fourth body, everything was easy. However, it is most difficult to conceive death and then accept it as another aspect of life is very difficult. But as you continue in meditation, you experience death. Fana is another name for death. Fana means dissolution. When I say death, does it mean that as you exist, you do not? Because you have an idea of death. Death means the dissolution of ego. You are a part of the whole. When a river merges into the ocean drop by drop, we call it fana or dissolution. It is death in another sense. Death means as you exist, you do not exist in that form after that experience. There is oneness. The river merges into the ocean and attains to the oceanic form. The cosmic, we are part of one cosmic reality. We are not alien nor as strangers joined. We are bound to each other by a causeless force. We are made out of the same stuff. Qualitatively, there is no difference between you and I. Quantitatively, we are made of the same stuff. Yes, qualitatively, there can be a difference. So, this is the experience of death which comes through the meditation. And it is important for attaining to the new dimension of life. Without knowing the other, you cannot know the first. To accept both life and death as two sides of the same coin is most difficult. This is pranic experience in the fifth body. It comes through meditation. From now on, things become very difficult. After the fifth body, ego drops completely. No more ego. You are one with all. The sixth body is the cosmic body. Everything is cosmic now. So the polarity takes the form of creation and destruction. Srishti and Pralaya. Srishti means creation and Pralaya means dissolution. This is the reason that from the sixth body onward, everything becomes very difficult to understand. According to Hindus, these forces are called Brahma, the creator, Shiva, the destroyer. One is concerned with creation, that is life, and the other is concerned with the preservation, and then the third aspect is concerned with destruction or dissolution. This body is a vast sphere of creation and dissolution as two aspects of Hindu Trinity, Brahma and Shiva. Every moment creation comes to you, and then every moment everything goes back into dissolution. A thought comes to you, an emotion arises in you, then it dissolves, it disappears, another comes in. So when the master says that he has seen creation and dissolution, he is speaking of the sixth body. Ego is no more. Everything is coming in and going out. You are simply a witness to all that comes into you and that goes out of you. This is the cosmic form. You are one with it. A star comes into existence. So it is your birth that is coming. And when the star disappears, it means you are going out. According to Hindu mythology, one creation represents one breath of Brahma, the creator. This is one cosmic breath. With one breath of Brahma, creation comes into existence, a star is born, and thus comes in the entire creation. And when the breath goes out, the star dies. An entire existence dissolves into non-existence. Means, now this can be understood, you are sitting down, and when you close your eyes to go into maraqaba for meditation, slowly and slowly, all that is there begins to disappear, or it is dissolving, it has become non-existence. Whosoever is sitting there becomes non-existence. Everyone is breathing in their own way, but there is only one breath. that comes in you and goes out. It is at this plane that everything is known about the creation and dissolution. So when the sheikhs and masters have spoken about creation and dissolution, it is because of this. The great Judo-Christian or Babylon or Syrian or Hindu aspect of dissolution, the end, all belong to this sixth body. This is no more an individual experience. This is cosmic experience. At this plane, you will envision everything as your own death. At this plane, you will envision everything as your own death. So, a Mahabir cannot kill an ant because an ant is made out of the same stuff as you are. This is no more the principle of non-violence. Instead, it is because of his own death. Such an experience belongs to the sixth body, that you cannot harm the other. Harming the other means you are harming yourself. Earth dissolves, another comes into existence. Even at this plane, one can get attached. Humanity must not die. But that which has come into existence must dissolve, including even the humanity. Before dissolution, life begins to take shape somewhere else. At this plane you experience the dictum, the Hindu dictum, Aham Brahmasmi. I am the ever-expanding consciousness. I am the ever-expanding consciousness. You are continuously expanding. Your consciousness is expanding. Moment to moment. Both Brahma, the creator, and Shiva, the destroyer or dissolution, are the polarity. But Vishnu, the third aspect of the Hindu Trinity, is beyond the two. The preserver is beyond the two. This is the Trinity of witnessing. This is nothing as Hinduism. It has a great insight into it. And what is important that human mind can understand when something deeper has been told in the form of symbols or stories. Stories hang around our consciousness and we can never forget these. Even those stories that you have heard as a small child, you remember them as you grow old. So the Brahma represents the creation, one polarity, and Shiva represents the another polarity. But beyond this polarity, there is something preservation. Preservation of creation when it is there, and then when the creation goes into non-existence, you are sitting with eyes open when it is a maintenance of that, it is to be preserved. Your emotions, your feelings, your understanding, your thoughts have to be preserved. When you go into meditation, you are entering into the state when thoughts are disappearing slowly and slowly. Emotions, feelings, and everything is dissolving. All those people who are sitting in the room, they dissolve into oneness. And then this is another polarity. And you have to go beyond the existence and non-existence, beyond the two, the emotion and disappearance of the emotions. Then the third force comes into existence in you, and this is the reason, according to Hindus, Vishnu is the most significant of the Trinity. Brahma is the creator, yet he is not worshipped so ardently. Then there are only one or two temples of Brahma in India, and that is relevant. We do not worship creation because it has already come into existence. He should be worshipped, but he is not. And Shiva has the largest number of worshippers because dissolution means death, and everyone is afraid of death. And when you are afraid of death, you begin to worship that death may not come to you. So he is seen everywhere. Just as stone is put and people start worshipping as a symbol of Shiva, human mind is so afraid of death that one cannot. That is why Shiva is worshipped more ardently than anything else. Of these, Vishnu, the preserver, the transcendence beyond the duality of creation and dissolution, that aspect is most substantial. That is why Hindus have the incarnation of this aspect of preservation, this aspect of transcendence, this aspect of witnessing as Ram and Krishna as the incarnation of Vishnu. Brahma creates for this witnessing aspect of Hindu Trinity known as Vishnu, and Shiva destroys for the same aspect of Trinity. So Brahma and Shiva are the two breaths of Vishnu. Two hands, the two polarities are like two hands of witnessing. Witnessing is transcendence. A tightrope walker has a pole in his hand. He leans to the left, he leans to the right, and he continues in the middle. Vishnu represents the middleness, the transcendence, the beyondness, and the left and the right two aspects represents the creation and dissolution, Brahma and Shiva. Brahma is the incoming breath. When breath comes in, you now look into yourself. Every moment a breath comes in and then it remains there for a while and then goes out. This process continues in human beings. Meditation means we pay attention to the incoming and outgoing breath. When the Sheikh told Leon Lefort that I taught Gurdjieff how to breathe, we breathe unconsciously, and that is why we do not understand the essence of meditation. When you are aware of the incoming breath and outgoing breath, then a moment comes you become aware of the transcendence, or you can become a witness to both incoming and outgoing breath. This is the third aspect. Hindus have given it a name as Trinity. The Trinity of Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva or Mahesh. This is nothing else but what happens in meditation. One breath comes in, it remains there for a little while, it is preserved for a few moments, it is maintained, and then it goes out. Creation and dissolution. And in between the two is the preservation. When we reach the seventh body, now, Brahma is the incoming breath, one aspect, Shiva is the outgoing breath, and this is what is meant by the cosmic form that Krishna shows Arjuna. To a devotee who is totally devoted, there is tremendous love in that individual for him, then he can see the cosmic form, and in that he can go beyond life and death. This is the three aspects which I had mentioned. First, the devotion. When in a marriage there is devotion, you are devoted to the cause of one another, bringing total fulfillment to the other. Out of this, love is born. And when love attains to fruition on the same tree, the third aspect, transcendence or witnessing, happens. You witness the two and out of that renunciation is born. This is important aspect. And this is the cosmic form. You begin to expand. Bliss begins to happen. And this is the transcendental transcendence in the sixth body as witnessing. So when you reach the seventh plane of the body, things become even more difficult. Buddha called this body as nirvanic body. Nirvanic means that which is a state of enlightenment. The seventh body is the manifestation of the absolute truth, the Hak. And the moment an individual attains to Hak, he enters into a different kind of realm. This is the absolute and the last state. There is no more creation and dissolution, only being and non-being. One moment you are there, then you do not die, because death happens only to the body. That which is in you, Ru, is never born, never dies, because Ru is not made out of any substance. It is pure light. It is pure awareness. It is consciousness that is never born, never dies. That's why we do not say that the master has died. We say master parda kar gaye. Parda means gone into a veil that you cannot see. Just as I am sitting in front of you, your eyes are open, you can see. When you enter into meditation, you close your eyes, you know that master is sitting in front of you, but you are not able to see with closed eyes. Then as the meditation deepens, even if the master disappears from there, he has left an aura of bliss in you as an outcome of the meditation, and that bliss or the surur remains alone. That is the aura of the Sheikh, the light or the nur of the Sheikh, and it is said he has entered with. If he attains to death at that time, dissolution, then it is called he has entered into Alami Ghayab, the realm where one reaches after dissolution. When the drop merges into the ocean, it attains the cosmic form. Now the no more restriction of the body is there, no more restriction of the mind. This is the state known as in Sufi terminology as Alami Ghayab. That is being and non-being. In the seventh body, there is creation of someone else. Both the being and the non-being are you. In this body, being and non-being are two breaths. One is not identified with either of the two. It is for those who have reached to the seventh body and have given a new religion. A holy prophet, a Buddha, a Mahabir, a Nanak have given a new way of life, a new way of transcendence which developed as a religion. Buddha spoke the language of non-being, the outgoing breath. To Buddha, nothing else is the reality. He uses the negative language. Shankar, on the other hand, uses the positive language. Holy Prophet uses the positive language. Shankar and Holy Prophet chooses the incoming breath, the being. These are the only choices as far as language is concerned. You can reach from one side to the other. Yet still there is another choice, the third one. Accordingly, nothing can be said about the reality. At the most, we can say absolute being or absolute non-being. Only this much can be said. Only transcendence is possible. So one has to choose between being and non-being, either the negative or the positive language. These are the approaches of Buddha and the approach of Shankar. Those who have chosen the positive as well as the negative. Through these seven bodies, life energy manifests into multidimensional realms. Wherever life is found, both incoming and outgoing processes remain. Life exists because of this polarity. I had begun with the example of the car battery, the bulb that is being lit in your house. It works on two polarities. Thus, it can be said that prana, the life force, is energy, the cosmic energy, and our physical body gives the first acquaintance of this light. Life first manifests as breath at the physical plane, then it goes on manifesting differently at different planes. The other form of this manifestation of life are influences, magnetism, thoughts, life, creation, and being. These are the seven bodies. In the first body, it comes as breath, then influence, then magnetism, thought, life, creation, and seventh as being. Thus this goes on. All these seven bodies can be experienced into any relation. When you are relating to someone, you can relate at either of these planes. When a sheikh relates to you, he uses all these planes. He begins with the physical plane and slowly takes you through all the other stages. You can enter into a male-female relation through this, and then a transcendence is possible. And as you reach to this third possibility, you transcend that body and enter into the next. When satiation happens at the physical